Hello, everyone, and welcome to the SCA's 47th monthly Zoom presentation. We have now completed almost 4 years of monthly Zoom presentations with no end in sight. My name is Brian Gallagher. I'm the president of the Society for Commercial Archaeology. I will be your host tonight. Welcome to all our guests and any new people we have with us tonight. We're happy you took the time out of your spring evening to watch an SCA presentation. I hope you enjoy the show. And for anybody watching the recording of this episode of the SCA's monthly presentations who's not a member of the SCA, we earnestly ask you to consider joining. Funding for the various activities of the SCA comes almost exclusively from our membership. Just visit our website at www.sca-roadside.org and follow the links. Now I have the pleasure of introducing tonight's presentation. In just 35 miles, the Pines to Palms Highway in Southern California takes one from the subalpine forests of pine and oak to the desert scrub of the Colorado Desert. The highway was conceived as a tourist highway to the famed resort of Palm Springs, but for many reasons, it was diverted from that city. Its history, and that of the two men who made it happen, is a fascinating story of a community effort during the Great Depression. Steve Leck is considered to be the historian of Riverside County, California. He has written or co-written 15 books on various topics related to Riverside County history. He co-authors the weekly Back in the Day column for the Press Enterprise newspaper and lectures on a wide variety of topics related to Riverside County history. In addition, he has been a docent at the historic Mission Inn Hotel and Spa in Riverside for 35 years. And has been on many history and preservation boards, commissions, and committees throughout the region. Without further ado, I'd like to ask Steve to start sharing his screen and let us have his presentation.
Okay, thank you, Brian. There we go. And we'll go, come on, we'll go there. All righty. Okay, can you see that?
Yeah, that's perfect. We got full screen and just the slide.
Okay, fantastic. Alrighty. Yes, as Brian mentioned, tonight's presentation is going to be on the Pines to Palms Highway, which has fascinated me since I worked for the County of Riverside for a number of years here. And it is truly a community effort in this. But in doing this, I noticed that I'm going to have to introduce it a lot differently for the international crowd. So let me give you a brief overview geographically here, and then we'll get into the history of it. But the name of it is the Pines to Palms Highway. It was built from the mountains to the desert there. And to give you an idea here, this is Southern California from space. Here's LA, San Diego, the inland area. And then if you notice this line here, that demarcates the inland valleys from the desert. So what we're going to be talking about is this area here, there. And this is a very unique region in Southern California here. I'm going to show you a slide here in just a minute. This is the highway we're going to be talking about in a few minutes. This is Mount San Jacinto Peak. It's the second highest peak in Southern California there. And this is the community of Palm Springs. And I know probably everybody's heard of Palm Springs before because of its fame and the like. But when you're staring at it from the north looking south, you are literally looking at a subalpine climate and the lower Sonoran climate or life zone within about 8 miles of one another here. And that has to do, of course, with the geography, the faulting that's in Southern California and the like. And that is what has set up this whole scenario where we can go from pines to palms within about 35 miles here. This view is always spectacular. We just had some snow up top here, of course, and it's, 70, 75 degrees there now. So you can look up and see all of that. So what is the highway? Well, the highway would take you not all the way up to the top of the mountain here, but within the San Jacinto Mountains, kind of heading down and directly into the desert. And that's what we've got in 35 miles. And within it, you go through three different life zones there. And so the life zones include the transition, which is the open woodlands area. And this is actually the beginning of it here. This is the little community of Mountain Center there. To take the Pines to Palms is going down this way to the southeast. But you can see exactly what we're talking about here. We're up in the pine forests of the San Jacinto Mountains. A little farther on, these are the views. And then we come on into the large mountain meadow that is Garner Valley, named for Robert Garner, who owned that for many years. In fact, the Garner family still does. This is the back of Mount San Jacinto, by the way, here. So give you an idea of where I'm taking this picture here. So you're there, and then you get to about, oh, say, mile 15 or 20 or so, and you start getting into the Upper Sonoran life zone. We have oak woodlands here. We have juniper woodlands and some of the desert scrub. You can see the beaver tail cactus and the like, plus other plants that are there. And of course, it's getting warmer. And we start to see our first views of the desert over here. And once again, that little snowy peak right there is Mount San Jacinto, just to give you an idea of where we've gone here. These plants are called red shanks or ribbonwood there, and they're very well adapted to this, the cold and the wind. And along this way, we actually have a spring right here, and it literally is where pine meets palm. You can hike down there. It's about, oh, I don't know, quarter mile, if that, off the highway, but it's the lowest point where you'll start, where you'll see palm trees, and about the highest that you'll see the palms there. And then finally, starting at about mile 25 or so, we get into the Lower Sonoran life zone. And this is what people think of when they think of the inland deserts of California. There, the low scrub, creosote bushes, that's what these green are here. We're on the highway down here as it snakes its way. This is called the Seven Level Hill because it switchbacks into the Coachella Valley, which is where the desert is here. Now you may know that name because starting Friday is the Coachella Music Festival, and it's down kind of over this way there to give you an idea where we are. The Ocotillo is in bloom right now. And as soon as it starts to dry out here in a few weeks, it's going to look deader than a doorknob for most of the rest of the year. But once we get a little bit of rain, boom, we get the Ocotillo along there. And so, this in and of itself, these different life zones can truly make a spectacular view when you're just driving the highway. And if you get to Southern California, I highly suggest that you do here. This one, I just made a stop and boom, there it was. Unfortunately, you can't see because of the clouds, but there are sugar pines up top here. And of course, we're down here with the yuccas and the cholla of the desert then. So, of course, the name was from very beginning, the Pines to Palms Highway. It wasn't the first one. It's not exactly a unique name here. The Jefferson Highway, I think, has given that that moniker there. But it was one of those advertising things. When you build stuff like this, especially at that time, you want to advertise it as much as possible. And that's because, as we said in the introduction, this was started partly as a tourist highway. All throughout early Southern California history, from the 1800s and through the 50s, and even today, getting that tourist dollar as the tourists come through here is a big deal. especially in the inland area, in the desert areas where a lot of people would come to winter. They would come to escape the winters of where else? The East Coast, Midwest, and the like. And so to have a place where they could drive through, drive to, the resort towns and the like, this is what's attracting people. And this is what they're trying to do. So we didn't at that time give our highways numbers like 1, 2, or 3, because that's kind of meaningless from a promotional standpoint. We would call them things like the Pines to Palms Highway here. Now, of course, we didn't think about it. I should say we didn't think it up to do this. Going between the mountains and the desert has happened for thousands of years here. The native peoples, called the Kaweah Indians, would spend their years going between the mountains in the summer and the deserts in the winter. And there were foodstuffs in the desert that they could have at that time, and then in the mountains, etc. And so these trails here are some of the network of trails that would be used by them. So this is certainly not a unique thing. When I talk about moving between the mountains and the desert, and the like, this has been going on for thousands of years, and well into, well, even today, too. So getting up into the mountains, that's kind of a big deal because, well, we have mountain resorts for the summer. And getting up there is kind of a hard time to do because, transportation isn't what it is today. So earlier attempts at making a mountain desert highway typically were more oriented towards Los Angeles. This is the early Idlewild Highway, Idlewild being the town that's up in the San Jacinto Mountains there. And of course, most people are coming from that direction at this time. So the concentration was getting them up there, and the like. Well, Riverside County, like so many other counties, didn't have a lot of money for road building. So they adopted a program that was getting its start here in California at the time, and that was using prison road labor to do it. And in the 20s, we started up the County Prison Road Camp for specifically that, road building and road maintenance. There. And if you stuck up a liquor store, a gas station, low-lying types of crimes, you would often be sentenced to a few months to a year or so in the prison road camp building roads. These were not, murderers and arsonists and the like. These were people typically down on their luck who were, like I said, sticking up a liquor store, gas station, what have you, there. So they built that initial road. And at that point, when they were done with it in 1929, we opted to just keep them going and start in on a road down to the desert that had been lobbied for quite a bit. And so here we see our beginnings then. Now, Palm Springs, who we all think of as sort of the big town here in the desert, was not at this time. Palm Springs was really just a winter vacation resort or winter health resort for people coming out here to try to bake tuberculosis, asthma, bronchitis, or whatever out of their lungs. These were people who would come out, hopefully get cured, but by the time April shows up on the calendar, most everybody's leaving, and most of the town kind of buttons up there. But that was going to be the initial configuration here. It was going to leave from up here, go down, and go down this, which is called Palm Canyon. It's a massive natural canyon with one of the highest concentrations of palm trees anywhere in the country there. So with that, they opted to just start building. And they started at a place called Keene Camp here. Now, Keene Camp is one of those many mountain camps that I was telling you about. John and Mary Keene operated a hotel in a nearby city, and they also operated this during the summer. There, many of the buildings that were there are actually still around, and the builders of the highway started up there and then continued on to the southeast, then with the prospect of going down Palm Canyon here. Now, you don't see it too much here, but when you look at the northern portion of it, where you actually get to go down and go hiking and the like, it's a beautiful area that would really have been a shame to run a road through then. Palm Canyon had already had numerous plans for it, anything from a national monument to a memorial to the soldiers who died during the Great War. And all, but at this point, we were looking at sticking a highway right through it and going down into Palm Springs, where it would meet up with the road from Palm Springs to the Hermit's Bench. And this was occupied by this gentleman here, William Pester. He's known as the Hermit of Palm Springs. And in doing some research on him, he's considered the first California hippie because he showed up here in California about 1906, and he was a draft dodger, but not from the American military, from the German. He was an immigrant from Germany, did not want to go into the army, moved out here, came to the desert, and lived the quote unquote natural lifestyle. Built himself a little hovel here. He would live off the palm trees and whatever else he could find, and he would draw pictures, he would do whatever he could. Eventually, he would sell his picture. You could go and pay him and take the picture and the like, and all. And so he was quite the character, as you can imagine. So I was going to connect up with his place and head on into Palm Springs of the time. It looks nothing like that now. If you know the area or been there, it looks nothing like it. But in about 1930, when we're talking about, that's what it looked like. So with that, construction started on. It's kind of interesting to note that construction started without a definite plan. And that, again, is a testament to the thought of having a highway for a tourist destination, that it was figured, well, everybody will want something like that. So we'll just go ahead and continue on. Well, things were about to change with that, because there were two men who came to the forefront here. The two men I call the two Wilsons, J. Wynn Wilson on the left, who is a businessman in Indio, and he's also the editor of the Indio Date Palm newspaper. So he's got a perfect voice for advocating for whatever he wants, because he pretty much runs the main newspaper out in the area. And then Wilson Howell on the right. Wilson Howell is the son of Wilson Howell Sr. of Menlo Park, there of Thomas Edison's lab. But instead of following in his dad's footsteps, he came out here to Indio, started doing some farming, found it to be a little too hot, so he moved up to the mountains. And he was one of the first organic farmers around. He would dam springs and use the water to grow all kinds of crops that he would sell and, of course, use himself there. And these two men, being closer to the Indio area, started advocating for the road to go farther east. Here's Palm Canyon that was going to go down here, but they wanted to see it go farther east. Now, why is that? Well, like I said, Palm Springs was a winter resort at the time. Pretty much folded up during the summer. Indio, however, was the big kid on the block as far as the desert area is concerned. And people lived and worked here full time, despite the heat. Indio was the railroad hub, so there were a lot of railroad workers because there was a massive railroad yard there with all the accoutrements. And also the agriculture in the lower Coachella Valley here was going great guns year round. So we've got people here who, during the heat of the summer, were trying to get away from it, at least to be able to sleep. And they thought if we could add a highway up into the mountains, maybe we could get up to some points here a little bit higher up and be able to maybe put cabins up or so and have a place to sack out where it'd be more comfortable. For those of you who aren't aware of this area, Indio can be well 100 degrees plus for a good chunk of the summer and sometimes into the 110s. And when it gets that hot for that long, night times are still 85, 90 degrees. So sleeping without air conditioning is a bit of a job for anybody, no matter how hardy you are there. So this is what they were trying to see. So they started advocating, the two Wilsons started advocating. They were writing letters, they were appealing to the Board of Supervisors, they were doing petitions, they were talking to anybody who'd listen to try to get that moved. And of course, they were up against some fairly good competition there because putting it in Palm Springs, which was already what they wanted to do, was going to make it closer to the LA region here. So the Wilsons decided they would advocate for it going through this area, Pinyon Flats, there, and then down aptly named Deep Canyon. If you get to the side of that, boy, it goes down real close or real quick, and then into Carrizo Canyon, and then into the desert itself here. So with that, now construction begins. And as I mentioned, construction begins, but we don't have a definite plan there. The very first section of it is, pretty definite. So with that, our county surveyor, Mr. Alex Fulmore, gets going. And he is the guy who laid out this highway and many others in our neck of the woods here. And he and his crew of surveyors got busy, and they went through the area without a plan either, because most of the work trying to get the proper route was left up to the politicians. So the portions that they knew were going to happen were being surveyed ahead. And since it's relatively flat and we were using prison labor, this is what the construction of it looked like here. This was the construction. It was pretty much pick and shovel, Fresno scrapers. They did have a few other tools at the behest of the County Road Department, but this was pretty much how it was done. This isn't a picture of it. This is the other highway, the first one I told you about. I didn't have any pictures of the Pines to Palms being built up this way, but it was not done any differently, certainly. So, anyway, a controversy about the route because a number of people were advocating for all kinds of different routes for this. They're already working on the red area. They thought they would go down this way and then up Palm Canyon. And there was a group advocating for the yellow route, basically up and over some mountains. That was quickly nixed. It was horrible shape. The newspapers talked about how the surveyors went up and over this route and they came back down to Palm Springs practically naked because the cactus and rocks and the like had ripped their clothes from them, etc. So they continued on down this way, and were able to negotiate with the Garner family in Garner Valley, because, of course, they were already building it. But then we came to, or started coming to, our first reservation, the Santa Rosa Indian Reservation, there. And the Santa Rosa Indians lived in this area down here. We see it saying Van Deventer Flats. Now, no one had consulted with them beforehand. Again, we're just building this highway. Boom. And the Santa Rosa Indians were somewhat less than thrilled about it, but then they saw it as a way potentially of getting some money in order to rebuild their failed irrigation system. We'd had floods in the last few years, and their irrigation system had failed. So negotiations at the behest of J. Wynn Wilson on behalf of the Indians with the county netted two positions that were very far apart The Santa Rosa Indians wanted about $10,000 for the right of way. The county was offering them about $1,000 and thought that was too high. Then eventually they were able to come to an agreement, but literally the survey and road crews were within about a few hundred feet of the Santa Rosa Indian reservation line when they did come to an agreement. And the agreement was to push the road north so it wouldn't take in so much of the reservation, and to give the Indians $5,000 for the right of way there. So it was a compromise, as you can tell. Then, so the crews started in again, the survey crews and the road crews and the like, and here we are. This is the Oak Grove that's on the Santa Ana, excuse me, Santa Rosa Indian Reservation there. It's a beautiful little spot then. And construction continues here, but they still have not figured out what route it will ultimately take at this point. And again, crews are getting close. Hey, we need to make a decision here, and it's time to choose a route. Well, at this point, then our second Indian tribe comes into play, and that's the Aguacali Ente people. Here is Palm Canyon. Nobody had thought to check with them first either, because they actually own a good chunk of Palm Canyon there. And so when it came time to really hunker down and start making decisions, officials from the county approached the Aguacaliente Indians, who flatly said no. They weren't going to give a right of way, no matter what the cost. This is our land, and we're actually sick and tired of people using it, because Palm Canyon was an extremely popular vacation place, weekend place. And during the weekends, especially like around now in spring, they would simply be overrun with cars, picnickers, and the like, people who would leave picnic baskets, tin cans, napkins, and the like. It was just basically a trashed place after several of the weekends. And if we go back here, whoops. The Indian reservation, for a number of reasons, was done on a checkerboard pattern here. And so many of the Indians were left with having to deal with some of the white settlers in with their cattle, because their cattle would, of course, get loose, and a number of the settlers would ransom them or hold them for money and the like, and they were just getting fed up with it. So at this point, they told the county absolutely not. And they fenced off the entrance to Palm Canyon and set up a fee booth, which is still there, too. If you go into what's now called the Indian Canyons, because there are three of them right there, you do pay a toll to go in there for obvious reasons. And with that, the county's decision was pretty much made for them, because they could not find the right of way. They couldn't, I should say, they couldn't get the right of way. And at the same time, our buddy Mr. Fulmore comes back with a with an estimate that says it would be cheaper to take the eastern route anyway and not go down Palm Canyon. So with that, the decision was made. People were hopping mad in Palm Springs, but as it turned out, the route would go across Pinyon Flats here, and then head out to the desert. Now we've got another issue, because up until this point, the route has been fairly flat. You think, okay, it's a mountainous area. It wouldn't be. Yeah, it is fairly flat. Now we get to the desert, and this is where it's going to get steep. Plus, the soil is going to get bad. And so the county appeals to the federal government, because they had an interest in getting people up to the mountains too. And the federal government takes over the desert portion here. You really need to have somebody who knows what they're doing, not a bank robber with a shovel or a pick, to start doing this area, because it is steep It is rocky and it is very loose. I mean, look at the soil here. And look at this. This is exactly what Frank Cuff was going through. He is a road builder from Los Angeles. He won the contract. And when I spoke to his son a number of years ago, he said, "My dad lost his shirt on this job." Because as you can see here, the minute he's, would make any progress, half of it would cave in. And he couldn't make the cuts work and the like. Of course, eventually he did, but it was after a lot more work than anybody ever figured. What I found fascinating is somebody who had done construction management for the county for a number of years was when I was in the archives, the National Archives, I found the request for proposals to do 10 miles of, to construct, I should say, 10 miles of state highway here, this state highway, because it was done to state highway standards. And it was 1 8.5 by 14 single-sided sheet of paper. That was the entire request for proposals. Now, we kill half a dozen forests just making them now, then, but it was just hilarious. It essentially said, you'll build it to these standards down here and we'll pay you this much. Boom. That's it. So anyway, Frank Cuff was able to make it work here. A couple of shots of grading along this too. We're obviously on the desert side. And then he actually subleased it out to another man, Milton Honick, to come up from the desert and meet him. And that's what we have here. That's Honick's area, and then that's Cuff's area. And they're within view of each other, but they can't travel it yet. So, anyways, well, true to form, as with any kind of very anticipated project like this, we decided to start celebrating the opening of the road well before it was done. As you can see by the newspaper here, we're looking at doing it in about mid-May. Then that was pushed a little bit, but here's the ribbon cutting ceremony on June 18th of 1932. Does that road look completed? Nope, it wasn't. But that's when they planned it. And because he was having so much trouble, though, with the soil, he was nowhere near done. So they went ahead and had the ribbon cutting. There's our buddy J. Wynn Wilson right here. There's Frank Cuff, Milton Honick, the two contractors, and a number of people, mostly workers in here. We got a Boy Scout and the like. And there is Mrs. Wilson right there to cut the ribbon. But as soon as they cut the ribbon, they had a big celebration. Next day, people started coming up, and it was just a nightmare because the road looked like this. And so it was closed again. The contractor closed it, and it didn't really open until about the end of July of 1932. Then. So with that, this is what the original alignment looked like here. It was all dirt. People tend to think, okay, it's a highway, we're going to pave it, right? No, not back then. You made it dirt, and then for about 2 years, you let traffic run all over it and compact it. You let the rainwater come and compact it, and then you go and pave it. Because they don't necessarily have the compacting materials or equipment to do it. Well, that didn't work for them because this became so incredibly popular. And we're talking about, at a time when the county's population was probably about 100,000 people, they were getting thousands and thousands of people coming up here over the several weeks to use this road. And so within about 6 months, they opted to at least oil it to keep the dirt down and also to keep the road there because they were having problems. And then eventually it was taken into the state highway system and paved, as you see here. And then, so with that, J. Wynn Wilson was went on to, he continued with his editorialship of the newspaper. He was congratulated several times over, and he was very, very happy about it. J. Wynn Wilson actually lived right along it, and he started up a little roadside place called Ribbonwood. Remember, I told you that the plants along the side of the road there in that one shot were called ribbonwood or red shanks. Well, that's what all this is back here. And he started this little area. It was a little roadside stop. That was his shop. He would sell little handmade trinkets. He would sell fruit and vegetables from what he made. The mail would come once a week, and so would ice. So if you came to Ribbonwood on Friday afternoon or Saturday or Sunday, you could get a cold drink. Otherwise, you got a outside temperature drink because the ice didn't come until Friday morning then. So that was that little place up in the mountains. And then at the opposite end in the desert, it met the main highway, what was called the Palm Springs Indio Highway there. And at that point, we had a new city emerge in the post-war era. And this was Palm Desert there. It's not as well known as Palm Springs, but it is Palm Desert. And there, a building, large Pueblo building like this was built by the Desert Magazine. And if you're familiar with the Southwest at all, or from there, you may know of Desert Magazine. It was very popular at the time. It's even probably more popular now, even though it hasn't been in print for 40 years or so. But that was printed there in what became Palm Desert, right at the highway there. So with that, that is what I have for you here. And if you'd like any other information on it, I do have the book on it, too. It's available through Amazon. But if not, I'd be happy to answer any questions, or try to at least.
Okay, thanks, Steve. That was remarkable. A very, very interesting story. I have a question.
Uh-huh.
And I have a couple of questions, actually. First of all, so before the feds came in and took over the construction, who was paying for this?
The county of Riverside.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it was strictly done by the county.
Yeah, so were they being motivated, I guess, by political reasons, or the two Wilsons and so on were pushing hard, I guess, for this to get the appropriation in order to build it. Would that be a true statement?
Yes, the county was doing it for a number of reasons. The Wilsons just simply wanted it to take a different turn,
right,
if you will.
Okay, that's interesting. We have a question here from Lisa Botluck, and she asks, was it a toll road?
No. Okay. No, it was a free highway when it was a county highway, and then it was fairly quickly put into the state highway system there so that they could maintain it. But we've never really had toll roads. It was just that one going into the Indian reservation to go to Palm Canyon.
Okay, that's interesting. Jeremy Ebersole asks, did more roadside attractions, motels, restaurants, etc., crop up along the road later on?
No. No, most of the land, especially up in the mountains, is either under state or federal ownership. And so and that has happened from years past to part of the Cleveland National Forest, San Bernardino National Forest, and the like. Now, the portion down at the desert has completely developed there. At the time that this was built, all it was basically a little two-lane highway going down to the main highway, would cover over with sand and the like. But no, now when you take it and go out into the desert there, you are met with thousands of homes, golf courses, commercial entities and the like. But once you get out of the desert and start heading up the hill there, it's pretty much just open and no development.
Okay. We have another question from Lisa. Lisa, would you like to ask this question yourself? I can unmute you here. Would you like to ask the question yourself?
Sure. I was just wondering, does this road still exist, and what's the condition of it?
Oh, yeah, very much so. I took the pictures About 2 weeks ago, or so that I showed you, because I won't travel to the desert now that Coachella's going on. But yes, it's beautiful. It is well worth going, but it is not a freeway. And unfortunately, a lot of people consider it as such. And it's rather twisty in places, and they do have problems with it. But if you do go, I would be cautious that way. But oh no, it's still a state highway. It's State Highway 74, and it's part of a much longer one that goes all the way to the beach.
When you say the beach, where's the beach? Which beach? What beach?
This would be, where does it go? San Clemente,
Oh.
down into Orange County. But from the beginning of the Pines to Palms Highway, that's probably a good 70-mile drive, 60, 70-mile drive.
Okay. Oh, that's interesting. Any did you oh a friend oh, anything else, Lisa, on your mind, or is that it? Maybe, yeah, she might be. Oh, here you go. Was there anything else, Lisa? I'll unmute you again if you have any other question.
Nothing else. Thank you.
Okay, thank you,
Thank
Lisa.
you.
Now, Francis has a question. Francis, did you want to pose this yourself? Let me see if I can find you here. It takes a minute to find the people. Well, I'll just pose it, and then maybe there's a follow-up. Her question is, was the WPA involved in any aspect of the construction?
Of the construction, no. This opened in July of 32, and of course FDR didn't get elected until November of 32, take office in 33, and then the WPA started after that. So they were not involved in the construction, but they were involved in some of the improvements done to it later on. Culverts, some of the sidings, and the like. They did do some work there. But no, this predated the WPA.
Okay. Francis, did you? I've unmuted you if you wanted to ask anything else. No, I guess not. Okay. Well, that's great. Well, that's all of our questions, Steve. I wanted to say again, this is, I mean, I never heard of it before. I'm from the East, so that may be, I'm in Canada, so that's even more remote. But next time I do head down there, I think I want to check that out. Because it sounds very, very interesting. So thanks again for your presentation. That was I found it remarkable. I just want to remind everybody about next week. Sorry, not next week, but next month. When on Wednesday, May the 8th, we will have Andrew Danish, who's also from Southern California, will be joining us or presenting to us a topic of interest from that part of the state as well. And the SCA members will be receiving the relevant details and registration link by email, but others can register through the SCA website directly. So thank you, everybody, that spent your evening with us tonight. Expect if you're not a member of the SCA right now, you can expect an email coming shortly that will invite you to join the SCA if you enjoyed tonight's presentation, and then you'll have all the benefits of SCA membership. And I'd also like to remind everybody that the recording will be posted on the SCA website, usually within a day or two. And if you know anybody that would like to watch, they're welcome to watch it. It's free, of course, for everyone. So, Steve, did you have any final words to say to our group?
No, just thank you for all attending. Glad you enjoyed it. And look forward to doing it again sometime.
Okay, well, we definitely will be having you back, no question about it. Probably later on in the year for another episode of Southern California history. Again, I thank you, and I will be sending you the recording tonight, and also the chat, and you could be able to see what people are saying. So again, thanks very much. Thank you everybody for joining us tonight, and I will say good night and look forward to seeing you all again next month.
Thank you.